Welcome back, band family. Let's warm up today by working on our face shape, our embouchure. We'll get a great workout for our chin in. Make sure you have a mirror with you, hold it in front of you, and make the M face. M. Next, let's do the EU exercise, where we say EU and firm up our chin and form the correct embouchure face position. EU. To develop the muscles in our chin, we're gonna do the same thing, but we're gonna hold it. And once again, I'm going to try to count while I hold that EU face. It's going to look and sound a little silly, but I tell you, it works. So let's do this. Ready? EU, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20. All right, how did you do? Were you getting a little bit tired in your chin right there? Make sure you're really thinking about flexing those muscles there to get a good workout in. So we just did that one time. What I want you to do right now is rewind the video just a little bit and do that two more times, three times in total. If you do this every day, three times, not only does it cement into your brain what your face should look and feel like as you play the clarinet, it's also gonna give you the muscle strength necessary to sound amazing. So two more times and then join me when you're ready. Let's begin by getting our instrument ready. We'll start with the reed. Take out a reed and lick both sides of it, and then place it in your mouth on top of your tongue to allow it to slowly moisten. You want to make sure that you leave it there the entire time that we're getting the rest of the instrument ready, because we want to make sure this is moistened and ready to go so we can play. Be very careful of the tip, because remember, it is so thin that light can actually shine right through it. So if you move it around, or if it touches your teeth, or if you talk while you have a reed in your mouth, you'll probably break that reed. Be careful. While that reed is soaking, let's take out the mouthpiece and the barrel. Remember that all the parts of the clarinet are shaped like a cone, so they are skinnier at the top and wider at the bottom. Make sure they're not upside down. I've already taken my mouthpiece and applied cork grease to the cork. If you haven't already done that, go ahead and pause this video and do that first. You might also want to have a paper towel nearby so you can wipe off the excess. When you first get a new clarinet, those corks are very thick, very dry, and it's going to be really hard to put this instrument together. So definitely put some grease on there first. As we assemble the instrument, we're always going to have our palms facing towards us, thumbs pointed toward the ceiling. Grab the barrel with your right hand and the mouthpiece with your left. It's important we always use the correct hands for each of these parts for reasons which we'll learn about later. For now though, barrel in the right hand, mouthpiece in the left. Palms toward me, thumbs towards the ceiling. And go ahead and line the two up and slide them together with a slight twisting motion. Don't let go of your hands yet. We always want to remove the bottom hand first. And again, there's reasons for that we'll learn about later on. Just get used to this idea that whenever you put two parts together, hang on to it with the top hand, let go of the bottom hand. The reed is still in your mouth, but while it stays there, I just want to remind you about where it needs to go on the mouthpiece. The flat of the reed should go to the flat of the mouthpiece. The two flats go together. Don't try to insert this into the hole. That doesn't work. Flat against flat. And it's going to be positioned so that it's left to right centered perfectly. And it also should be even with the end. If it sticks up over the end, that's too far. By the way, if it was sticking up too far, would you press down on top to push it back? No, that would break the reed. So you can hold the reed once it's moistened in position just like that. So right now I have my left hand on the mouthpiece and barrel, and the thumb is holding the bottom of the reed in place, flat against flat, and then that shiny, thicker part is on the bottom. I'm gonna grab the ligature so that the skinnier end is on top and the wider end is on bottom, and I'm gonna slip it over the top of the mouthpiece. As I do this, I wanna be super careful that I don't accidentally chip the end of the reed. It'd be very easy to damage it. Now, the ligature is nice and loose, right? And the higher up it goes, the looser it is. As I pull it down, it's gonna get tighter. So I'm gonna wanna grab this with my thumb and pull it tight. But to do that, I need to hang onto the reed. So with my right hand, I'm gonna put my thumb and first finger right up top to pinch the top to make sure it doesn't go anywhere. At that point, I can grab the ligature with my thumb, and I could pull it tight, except that probably the reed may have shifted a little bit. So before I pull it tight, I'm actually gonna use both thumbs to slide that reed exactly where it needs to be so that it is centered left to right and even with the end. Once it's in the correct spot and I've made sure, I'm going to pinch the top. With my left hand, I'm going to pull that ligature down tight, just like that. To make sure it doesn't go anywhere, I'm going to tighten the screws just enough to keep it from moving. We mentioned last time that once you get those screws in the right spot, it's easy to put the ligature on and take it off with barely any motion of those screws. When I remove it, I will barely loosen them up, and off it comes. When I put it on the next day, slip it on there, pinch here, adjust if needed, pull it tight, and I barely need to move this. That's all there is to it. This is a standard ligature because the screws are facing to the right, and the screws are going to be down here near my chin, and I tighten these with my right hand. This ligature screws are always tightened with the right hand. Even if you're left-handed, it's always our right hand. Now, if you had what's called an inverted ligature, where the screws are designed to go on the backside, that means those screws would then come out this way. The shape of the ligature would also be different. The way it's built would be different. It's specifically designed to be applied that way. This is not an inverted ligature. It's the wrong shape. And plus, the screws are facing the wrong direction. This is an inverted ligature. It's one of several different styles. Sometimes inverted ligatures look just like a standard, except the screws are facing a different direction and it's shaped slightly differently. This is an inverted ligature that also looks quite a bit different as well. It's made out of a kind of a spongy, fabric-y, kind of rubberized material. And it's a little bit different style. When I place this one on, it still works the same way. I'm going to put it over on top very, very carefully. Pinch the top right here, grab it with my thumb, and pull it tight. At that point, I'm going to tighten the screw just enough to hold it in place. And so this inverted ligature has the screw on the back side rather than down here, but it works the same way. Double check to make sure that your ligature is in the correct spot. It should be in the bottom half of that reed. Again, I used the example last time of if the reed was a human person and we had that ligature there, that would be where their pants would go. So the top part of the ligature, like the waistband of the pants, should be at the halfway point of the reed. If it's way too high, like way up there, that's like hiking those pants all the way up to your armpits. Similarly, if it's all the way down below at the very feet, that means our pants are sagging. We don't want that. Not a good look for a reed, so we want to make sure that that reed is in position, ligature there. My mouthpiece has lines above and below where the ligature goes. Yours might have them as well. That's another way to double check to make sure your ligature is in just the right spot. Let's go ahead and play the air to sound exercise. This is the one where we form the EU face. We bring the mouthpiece up into position, slide it into place by inserting it until the teeth touch the plastic of the mouthpiece. You should also feel, in addition to that pressure against the top teeth, you should feel the pressure of the bottom teeth through the lip into the bottom of the reed. For air to sound, we're going to blow air, and then we're going to increase the pressure in the middle of blowing until we get a sound out of the instrument as well. You. How did you do? Were you able to get a sound? Some things to think about. Make sure that the mouthpiece goes in far enough. If you're in the very, very tip of the mouthpiece like this, you're not going to get any sound because you probably won't even get any air through the instrument. You can't be at the very tip of it. You have to go far enough in that the reed can vibrate. If you get this really incredibly loud shrieking, screaming, shrill sound, you might have gone in too far. I gave you the advice in our last lesson that you should experiment at different spots to find the sweet spot right in the middle. If you're too far out, it's hard to blow. Too far in, it screeches. So right in the middle is where you want to be. Feel that pressure against that top teeth. You actually have to think about pressing up against those top teeth, and you should also feel the pressure against the bottom as well. Let's try again. This time we're going to do instant sound. Blow and immediately produce the sound by using enough pressure. EU. So the true test to find out if everything is correct in your embouchure is if you can produce the correct pitch. On the Bandmate app, if you set it to clarinet and you have that little switch on the right-hand side set to the flat position, which is the top position, on Bandmate, with this by itself, you should produce an A flat. Again, that flat symbol is the half of a heart with a line through it or a pizza on a stick. If you can produce an A flat on Bandmate with a mouthpiece and barrel, you're doing the right thing. It means that everything is correct. If you're not getting an A flat, if it's lower, if it's a G or an F or even an E, there's something going wrong. And I'll give you some troubleshooting tips to help you get there. But first, let's see how you're doing. Take out your Bandmate app on a device and check to see what note you get. Let's see if you can get an A flat. E, U. Okay, troubleshooting. Let's see if we can find some solutions if you're not able to get that A flat. First, make sure that your teeth are on the back of the plastic. So top teeth right there in the plastic. If you can't feel that pressure against your top teeth, it's not gonna work. In fact, I mentioned several times pressure. Yeah, you should actually feel like you're pressing up against your teeth. If you had a loose, wiggly baby tooth in front, it would probably come flying out of your face if you were pressing up against it with a clarinet mouthpiece and barrel, because there is some pressure going up against those top teeth. Second, you need to have some pressure against the bottom teeth as well, but remember that lip is in between the bottom teeth and the back of the reed. If you have no lip there, if your teeth are falling back, yeah, it's not gonna work. As I'm doing this, I'm actually kind of thinking about pressing this way with the clarinet mouthpiece and barrel. So feel like you're kind of going this way, and you'll find that it presses against the top teeth, and it also presses against those bottom teeth through the mouthpiece. So it should feel that kind of pressure right there. We also want to make sure that our angle is correct. If you're way out like this, it's not gonna work. You're gonna get the wrong note. It's gotta be in like this. To figure out how much space you need, if you were to put your finger right there, for most people, on most people's chins, the bottom part of this will touch your finger. And that's why when we do the EU face, we slide it up this way. We don't go in that way. We actually slide it up to keep it fairly vertical. If you're way out here, it's not gonna work. Check it out. EU. And I'm actually touching right there. So that's a great way to double check your angle. If you don't touch your finger at all, you know it's gonna be too low. If you can't get your finger in there because it's right up against your face, you'll probably get a squawking sound and it probably won't work at all. Normally the squawking sound happens when you go in too far. You can get a different kind of squawking sound if you're like way down like that. So it's about a 45 degree angle, maybe a little less, somewhere thereabouts. We can also think about firmness around our mouth. If you had a pair of sweatpants with a drawstring waist and you pulled the string, it would apply pressure all the way around. The same thing is true of your lips. You should apply pressure all the way around. And, you know, I tell you, normally the things that we do in life, like if you're eating a hamburger, a lot of the pressure from your teeth and from your lips is coming down. But in clarinet, we also need to think about coming in from the side. So I sometimes think about using some side pressure here and squeezing all the way around the mouthpiece, including from the sides. The final tip I can give you is tongue voicing. Tongue voicing is the position of your tongue. It's the vowel your tongue position is in. So if you were to say E, your tongue is in a very high position. If you saw an X-ray from the side of your face, your tongue would be up like this. If instead you said ah, your tongue would be very low. And the syllable we need for clarinet is E. You need to be thinking E as you blow. So that gets a little tricky to think about because we're not actually saying anything. Don't speak the word E. You're gonna just have your tongue in that position. I'll show you what I mean. Go ahead and make the M face and then do the EU, but I want you to say E as well. EU, E. Now I want you to do the same thing, but transition from saying E to just whispering E or breathing E. E. That time I was blowing air, but my tongue was raised up as if I was saying E. Another thing you can try doing is hissing like a cat. Now hiss like a cat, but have your face in the EU face. Now, when you hiss like a cat, you're actually kind of closing off the back of the throat, and we don't actually want that much closing down, but your tongue is probably in the right position. Here, try something once. Say E and think about where your tongue is, and specifically think about where your upper back molars are. E. You'll probably notice that your tongue is touching your teeth in the back, your molars in the back. I've never thought of that until somebody pointed that out, and it blew my mind. Yeah, when you say E, your tongue is actually touching your teeth. So when we're playing clarinet, if you want that E tongue voicing, you need to get that tongue up high It's similar to the vowel E, not exactly the same, but similar to it. As an experiment, try playing the same note and move your tongue around like this. E, ya, e, ya, e. We're not actually voicing it though, so you're gonna go. So you'll notice there, as I went from E to A, it changed the pitch that I was producing. It was an A flat when I was saying E, but when I said ya, and my tongue dropped down, it changed to a different pitch. So on clarinet, we pretty much always need to be thinking H or E as we blow. I'm gonna show you how to add one more part onto your clarinet. Over the next couple weeks, we'll keep adding part after part after part. And the part we're gonna add today is called the upper joint. Looks like this. It's the larger part in your case that has two corks, a cork on either end. If your part only has a cork on one end, that's the wrong part. That's the lower joint. We want the upper joint. And like all parts of a clarinet, it's slightly bigger at the bottom than at the top. It's kind of hard to tell, but it is. Another thing you can tell is that the keys will generally become smaller as they go up. If you looked at the lower joint, those keys are quite a bit bigger. When we attach this to the barrel, it's not going to go in easily unless we grease the corks. So take some cork grease and put plenty of it around this top cork. While you're at it, you might as well grease the bottom cork. We're not going to use this one yet, but if you start to kind of work it in a little bit, it'll help. As you apply that cork grease, not only do you need to apply it, I would try to rub it in with your finger, like really work that grease into the cork to help make it a little bit more smooth. Once you have the top cork greased, I'm going to show you how to correctly hold the upper joint for assembly. Now, the way we hold the instrument is different when we assemble it from when we play it, so it's important to remember that. As we assemble the clarinet, we're going to be looking at the part that the audience sees. We're going to look at the front part of the clarinet that everybody else sees. We're not gonna hold it so we can see the back where we normally see. We're gonna see the front of the instrument. On this part, the upper joint, we're gonna hold it with our left hands. It's important to remember that the keys and the rods and all the metal parts of the clarinet are much more fragile than they look. You'd think they'd be really tough because they're made of metal, but no, they're not. They can bend. Think of it like a paperclip. You know how you can bend a paperclip? Yeah, you have to be careful even though they're made out of metal. I never wanna apply any sideways pressure to any of these parts. If I do need to touch a metal part, I'm gonna be very, very careful. In this part, we do have to touch some metal parts. I'm gonna show you how to do it safely. You're gonna hold the instrument with your palm facing towards you, thumb pointing towards the sky, and we're gonna put most of our hand on the back where there is no metal keys. So put your hand there. And then I want you to put your thumb alongside and your left fingers, you're gonna hold down these keys right there. We're gonna hold them down to keep them safe. This is how we're gonna hold the upper joint for assembly. Not how we play it, but just to assemble. Make sure it's facing right side up. If it's backwards, you'll notice there's all these little metal keys sticking up. No, that's backwards. You wanna make sure that those little metal parts along the side are sticking down. And there's that cork that we greased. We don't need that one yet. We just need this cork up there. Once you have this in position, go ahead and grab your barrel. Now we've already assembled our mouthpiece and barrel, which is fine. So when I hang onto this barrel, it's already assembled. Sometimes though, when we assemble the entire instrument from scratch, we won't yet have the mouthpiece on. But in this case, we do. Remember, right now we're looking at the audience's point of view. So we're not gonna be seeing the reed. We're gonna be seeing the backside like that, really the front of the instrument. So I'm gonna hold this with my right hand, palms toward me, thumb up top, and I'm gonna slide these two together just like this. This might be hard to do. So this is where you wanna make sure you get those corks greased. Grease them every day, really work it in with your fingers. We're not quite done though. We need to do two things. First, I wanna make sure that the reed is lined up with the long skinny key in the back. So I'm gonna adjust it until it's there. The second thing we need to do is we need to pull this barrel out just a little bit, about that far. On camera, you may not even be able to see it, but I've pulled it out just a fraction of an inch. Once it's there, I can let go of the bottom hand. Remember, we always let go of the bottom hand. At this point, you can set it down in your lap while I explain why I pulled that barrel out just a little bit. When you look at it, it seems incorrect that it's not pushed all the way in, but that is correct. And that's because on every single instrument, there is a spot that is not fully pushed in. That is how we tune the instrument. Our instruments are filled with air, and the temperature of that air can change the sound of the instrument. If it was really hot air, it would make the pitch of the instrument slightly higher. Think of it this way. If you have helium in your lungs, your voice changes, right? How would it change? it'd be higher, right? That's because helium is less dense than regular air. If I had really hot air inside my instrument, hot air is also less dense than room temperature air. And so like helium, it would make the instrument sound slightly higher. Not nearly as much as helium, but a little bit. And so that's why we need to have the ability to change the size of our instrument. If I push it in or pull it out, it can compensate for that temperature of the air. Same if I was playing outside and it was the middle of winter. The air in the middle of this instrument would be very cold, and so I would need to adjust the position of the barrel to compensate for the effects of that cold air. Long story short, the room temperature setting of the clarinet is for that barrel to be pulled out just a little bit. And if you look at every instrument in the band, every single instrument has one little spot on it that can be adjusted based on the temperature of the air inside. I'm going to teach you a note, and then I'm going to teach you a game. We're going to play the mouthpiece and barrel like we did before, except now we have this upper joint on the end. So you'll still hold this the exact same way. And the first two notes I'm actually going to teach you today involve having this upper joint on there. The first is to simply bring our instrument up into our face and blow. Our left hand remains at our side. Don't touch anything else, left hand at your side. As you play that note, it's going to be a G. U. How did you do? Were you able to get a sound? It can be a little bit tricky at first because with the extra weight of that upper joint there, it sometimes makes it a little bit harder to control. If it doesn't work, you can try taking off the upper joint and try just with a mouthpiece and barrel to remind yourself of how that should feel. Then you can reassemble the top part of your instrument and try it again with the upper joint in place. You can also check the angle, make sure you have enough mouthpiece in the mouth, all the things we talked about before. Now, I call that note a G. That's because every note has a name, a letter name, A, B, C, and the note that we can play with no fingers at all on our left hand on the upper joint, we call that note G. I'm going to show you one more note today. This next note is called E. To play an E, we'll start by taking our left thumb and placing it right here on the back of the instrument. Make sure this is your left hand that's doing this part. Don't have your hands backwards. Right hand on the barrel, left hand on that thumb key. As you put your finger there, don't touch that long skinny key, but it's a good idea to have your thumb so close to that long skinny key that it's almost touching it, but not quite. So the thumb is there, and usually it's about a 45 degree angle, not straight up and down, not straight in, about a 45. On the front of the instrument, go ahead and place your index finger, your first finger, on that top ring. You'll see that there's a ring, and a hole. We're going to put our first finger on that top ring. Leave the other fingers floating in air near the instrument. Don't have them way out here, have them close. This note is called E. Go ahead and play an E. You'll notice that for both the G and the E, I held those notes as long as I could, and I made them very steady and even. They didn't get louder or softer, the pitch didn't change at all, my pressure was consistent the whole time, the sound didn't stop. That is our goal. Hold notes as long as possible. Develop that strength. I'm going to teach you one more thing today. I know we've already learned the G and the E, which is more than I would normally do in the second lesson, but I want to share with you a game. This game is called How Low Can You Go? We're going to start by having our fingers in position to play an E. Thumb on the back, thumb key. First finger on that top ring. As you play that E, in the middle of playing it, add a finger and then add a finger. See if you can get those other notes below. They may not work, but let's see how low you can go. I'll demonstrate and show you what it should sound like. As you try this, are you able to get those notes to sound? You might only be able to get some of the notes to sound. And what's actually happening there is air might be leaking out underneath your fingers. As I finger E, if air is leaking out anywhere around it, it's not going to sound like an E. Same when I add that next finger. If that finger is not perfectly centered and forming an airtight seal, if it's off to the side a little bit, air will leak out next to my finger and the note won't sound. Same way when I get down to that third finger. If I don't fully seal that hole, air is going to leak out. It's not going to sound right. I'm going to try this again, but I'm going to do it incorrectly. I'm going to miss my second finger key. So as I start with an E and I go down to the next note, I'm going to miss it by not being in the center. See if you can hear it. You might have noticed that it didn't sound quite the same. Oftentimes, if your finger doesn't fully seal, it'll start to sound a little airy. The pitch won't be quite right. And then as you add additional fingers beyond that point, those will also sound kind of airy. They won't sound quite right. So in order for you to be successful playing the how low can you go game, you need to make sure you're fully sealing each one of these fingers. I find it particularly helpful to play the how low can you go game in front of a mirror, especially a long full length mirror. If you can get in front of a long full length mirror, you can easily see, oh, hey, my finger was not in the right spot, and then fix it as you go. So you have a lot to work on this week. You can start out by working on that strengthening exercise for your chin every day. Then proceed to assembling the top part of the instrument correctly. Double check that reed position every time. Do some air to sound and some instant sound exercise. And really, being able to produce that A flat is the single most important thing you can be doing. I usually have my beginners spend several minutes every day, like 5 minutes a day, playing A flats with Bandmate, making sure that they consistently can get that sound every time. Think about all those troubleshooting tips I gave you, and make sure you rewatch this video to see them again if you're having problems. Then, as a bonus, you can put the top part of the instrument together, making sure we hold the upper joint correctly, barrel correctly, and then do G's, E's, holding each as long as you can, and if you'd like a little extra challenge, try the how low can you go exercise. So, every day this week, work on those things, and you'll be progressing wonderfully. Until next time, go practice.